care if they remember me. Only Jesus.
Well, it is great to see so many of you here this morning in God's house. Let's stand together as we enter into worship in the Father's house this morning.
2, 3, 4.
midst of difficult times like we're facing today. And Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness in meeting all of our needs during this time. Lord, I thank you for the faithful giving of the people in this congregation. I thank you, Lord, that each of us has food on our table. Thank you, Lord, that we have a warm house to sleep in at night, things that we often take for granted. And Lord, we know that you have helped your people through many difficult times throughout history, and you will continue to be faithful to us in this time. Lord, we look to you as our provider. We look to you as our help in these times of need. Pray, Lord, that you would inspire us to help others, to reach out, and to be little Christs in our world. Help us, Lord, to be your servants and to help reach those who have needs in this community. In your name we pray.
Thank you. You may be seated. Good morning, Fremont Lions Church. Those worshiping with us online and in person, we're excited to worship our awesome God. My name is Brandon. I'm the youth pastor here. Just a few bits of information for our church. Last week, Pastor Tom informed us of the passing of Shirley Ewing. We want to make sure that you're aware of her memorial service, that's tomorrow, August 17th, at Mosier's at 10 a.m. Additionally, next Sunday, we have an exciting Sunday. It's our kickoff Sunday. Next Sunday, we'll be installing Pastor Jeremy as our senior pastor in the 9 a.m. and the 11 a.m. services. Additionally, we'll be having an outdoor reception for him and his family at the 10 a.m. time, so in between those services. Additionally, Kids Connect will also be kicking off that at the 11 a.m. service. And we have some exciting news regarding Kids Connect that Jeremy's going to talk about.
Yeah, Julie, Jamie, if you guys want to come up. This is a little bit of a bittersweet morning for us. As some of you know, Jamie is, I'm going to mix your two names up over and over. I know I'm going to. Jamie is stepping away from her role as director of kids ministry. She's stepping away from that role to continue to pursue her education in counseling. And so if you know Jamie, you know that is a perfect place for Jamie to be, and it's going to be a really, really great ministry for her, I think, in the future. And so we're really excited about her pursuing her education in that way. It's been three years that she's been our director of children's ministry, and so we're just really grateful for all the ways in which she has ministered to our kids and to volunteers and to our families. And so with that sad news, we're also excited to announce that Julie is going to be our next director of kids ministry. And Julie and her family have been a part of our church family for years. And what she said in first service, she has been the co-director of our preschool for 28 years. And so we are just so excited to have her in this new role. And so would ask for your involvement in this, in terms of, we ask that you be praying for them, be praying for our kids' ministry as a whole, be praying for Julie in this new role as she kind of gets her feet underneath her and learns the ropes. And we're excited to have, even though Jamie's going to be pursuing her education, she's still going to be staying on for just a few hours to assist Julie. And so just this team, we're really excited about for the future of kids ministry. So if you'd be praying for them, and then also maybe after the service, if you see them, you can thank Jamie for her ministry and say hi to Julie and just encourage her as she continues into this new role. So let's pray together. Father, we are so grateful for Jamie and for Julie. We're grateful for the ministry in which you have given them over these many years, and just the lives that have been so positively impacted, the kids' lives who have been changed in the ways in which you have used them. And so as we look back on what it is that you've done, we're grateful for all of that, Lord, but we also are so excited as we think about the future of our kids' ministry and what it is that you want to do. I pray for these two as they seek to lean into you and to trust you for whatever that is, Father. And so we just would ask that whether it's this fall and just sort of the craziness of what this fall is going to look like for us, Lord, so whether it's over the next few weeks or months or even years, Father, we just ask that you would use them, use the team of volunteers that are working with these kids to have a huge impact in their lives. God, would kids be encouraged? Would they grow in their faith? Would there be kids that walk in these doors, hear the gospel for the first time and put their faith in Jesus? We ask that you would do that. We ask that you would use this team in that way. And so we just thank you for all that you have done, and we look forward to what it is that you're going to continue to do. And so we pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Well, I just want to extend a huge thank you to everyone who has been so supportive on this journey of mine. And recently Jeremy had reminded me of the day that I walked into the church, and I was like, I wish I could work here. And then they're like, you can. So that's kind of how it started out here. But it's just been such a wonderful experience serving as the director of children's ministry for the past 3 years. And as bittersweet as it is to close this chapter, I'm just humbled by how God has used this experience to guide me into the next chapter of my life. And as I become more aware of how crucial it is to disciple the next generation, I look forward to continuing serving in Kids Connect by volunteering and working alongside Julie. And I prayed fervently for the next director alongside the leadership staff here at church, and always felt that Julie Johnson would just be perfect for this role. She loves teaching children to not only know about Christ, but to fully love and experience who he is. And she shares the same heart and vision for Kids Connect and will also be able to further that vision in more ways than I can in this season of my life. So we go through this pathway for Kids Connect that goes alongside Fremont Alliance, which is to reach up, reach in, and reach out. And so that is that in Kids Connect, we recognize and we believe that children need to be fully dependent on Christ, and because he loves them so much, he sacrificed his life for them. And so our desire for children's ministry is to encourage children to become more like Christ in their hearts, their words, their actions, and we strive to create an environment for them that will reach the children with transforming love of Jesus Christ. And so we're going to reach up to God by encouraging children to become worshipers of God. Everything begins by looking up to God, who desires a relationship with each and every one of us. And Kids Connect strives for kids to value scripture, receive grace, obey, love, and worship the one true living God. And so we begin our path of spiritual growth by reaching up to God, who is our source of life and reason for living.
We reach in by encouraging children to become part of a community of believers. Relationships are key to the Kids Connect ministry. We believe that everyone is valuable, no matter how old they are or what age they will become. They need to be included in the body of believers, and rather than looking at children as they are young and not able to do things, that we need to encourage them in their growth and guide them and teach them and take ownership in their character and a place in the body of Christ. We reach out by encouraging children to take part in the ministry of Christ. Kids Connect want to help children understand their calling to share Christ with others each day. We also want to teach children that we can be on a mission for Christ even in our own community. There are always opportunities to share Christ in the ways that we think, in the ways that we act, and what we do. It is just as important that we encourage children that they themselves have the ability to do this, no matter how old they are. I am humbled and grateful that I get to have this opportunity to work with the Kids Connect program. Jamie, even though she might have really little feet, she has great big shoes to fill, and I am thrilled with this opportunity, and I'm also really grateful that she's going to work alongside me because she is such an impact to this church. So as we get ready for kickoff next week, I want to say that I am super excited that I'm going to be able to see the children come into the church, and I'm going to be able to work with them, and they're going to be able to be in this building with our body, with our family again, and that will be so exciting. Having said that, we are still going to be having online things for those who are still going to worship at home. Hello, online worshipers! And I will look forward to doing that too. I just am really, really looking forward to, with great anticipation, what God is going to do next in this church, in this community, and beyond. So as we talked about Kickoff Sunday, we're going to watch a little video about what happened last year and some of the fun things that happened then to give us a little peek of what could happen next year.
like David loved Jonathan. I love you like a puddle loves rain and a cow loves moo. If you need any help, you know what to do. I'm your friend. You always feel loved and you always feel blessed. That life's more fun than you ever could have guessed. Hope you know from the start just how great God thinks you are. Hope you get a home run on the kickball field and you learn super quick how to ride two wheels. Hope you get less homework and more recess. Hope you know all the words on your spelling test, T-E-S-T. David loved Jonathan, and I love you. Like peaches love trees, and your hair loves the dew. When you're happy, you'll see that I smile too. I'm your friend, and I love you. I hope you never feel lonely, never get scared, never unhappy, or find yourself somewhere where you don't want to be and you can't really see your way. 'Cause I love you. Ooh, ooh, ooh. I love.
There's nothing.
Lord, as we enter into a time of teaching now, I pray that the Holy Spirit would indeed work in our lives. Your word promises that your Spirit would come, it would guide us into all truth, it would convict us of sin, and it would comfort us. And no matter what we need this morning, Lord, whether it be truth and instruction, whether it be comfort, or whether it be conviction, I pray, Lord, that we would let your Spirit have his way with us this morning as we hear from your word. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Worship team, thank you. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and grab them. Turn to Galatians chapter 3 as we continue our study in the book of Galatians. I was 15 years old when I heard the news that I dreaded so much. It was the day that my parents sat me down and said, "Jeremy, we think it's time that you get a job." I didn't want a job. So this was not welcome news. I always just felt like staying at home and doing nothing sounded like a better plan. They didn't feel that way and said, "You know, you need to earn some money. You need to go find a job." And so I looked around town trying to find something that I wanted to do, something I thought would be fun, and I couldn't find anything that I wanted to do. I ended up working at the food court. Some of you probably have been here at the food court of Nebraska Crossing Outlet Mall, and it was not as nice then as it is now, and frankly, it was really not a great job. The only silver lining to that cloud was the fact that I got to work with a number of people that I was friends with, and we used to like mess around the whole time and not get any work done. And we found this like club thing at our work, and a club is not really like an adequate way to describe it. It was more like kind of like a medieval weapon. It had like spikes on it. I had no idea why it was there, but we used to like chase each other around and like hit each other with it. And one of the days at work, my boss came to me and said, "Today you're going to be working pizza." We served pizza and sandwiches and a whole bunch of other stuff. "Today you're going to be working pizza." I didn't know how to make a pizza. They had not trained me to make a pizza. So I'm not sure I really knew what I was doing, except for the fact that on the wall there was a piece of paper that described sort of the process of making a pizza, including like exactly where to put each individual pepperoni. And so I'm looking at this piece of paper and I'm making this pizza, and it's like one of those like real pizza oven things. You had to like scoop it up and like slide it in, you know, one of those things. And the pizza was cooking, my very first pizza. I was very excited, and I pulled this out. And most of you would know or be able to recognize a pizza probably by a couple of things. One is that it is round, and two is that it is a very flat sort of thing, right? My pizza was neither of those things. Okay, it was not a circle, and it had this huge bubble in it. And I'm not sure why that was, but it had this bubble in it. And so my manager comes in, and he's all upset because now he's got to sell everything that I make half off. Okay, and pizza after pizza after pizza, like, this just never came out right, and they always looked horrible, and he'd always have to sell them half off. And it came to the day when he had decided that it was best for the organization that I was no longer employed at this place. And so he let me go. And my last day of work, my friends came up and was like, "Oh, you know, did you get fired?" And I'm like, "Yeah." And I'm like, "I kept making these pizzas and they never came out right." And they're like, "Did you use the roller?" And I'm like, "What roller? What are you talking about?" "Well, apparently this medieval device that we were hitting each other with like had a purpose. That I was supposed to like roll the pizza dough and it like put holes in it like to get rid of the air in the dough or something like that." And so I was like, "Oh, that would have been good to know." But I had been using it, but I had not been using it, if you're following me, I had not been using it for the purpose with which it was created, right? And so I think anytime we're using something and we don't know what the purpose of it is, we can get ourselves into trouble. I think that anybody who is learning to drive for the first time might get themselves into some trouble if they don't understand what that hanging red light in the sky means, right? If they don't understand that. Or if somebody were to buy a bottle of chemicals of some kind and on that bottle is a skull and crossbones, They would be wise to not understand that to mean that this product will help you lose weight. I'll let you think about that for a second. But it's poisonous, right? And so if you're using something, not understanding what its purpose is, you can get yourself into some trouble. And that's the reality of the text that we're going to be looking at this morning, is that you can't make the most of something without understanding its purpose. And more specifically, when you don't understand the purpose of the law. And if you remember, Paul's calling, very specifically, is to the Gentiles, okay? So Paul's calling is to a group of people who have very little knowledge of and very little experience with, very little understanding of the law. They knew very little of it, okay? And so Paul is coming into these cities, and he's preaching this gospel of faith alone in Jesus, and raising up leaders and planting churches and writing letters back to these cities to encourage them, like the letter that we're studying right now. Okay, so Paul was very actively involved in planting seeds of the gospel in these places that he went, and the Judaizers would come in after the fact and would lead people astray with a message of, well, I mean, Paul's message is fine. I mean, this message of faith is good, but it's not complete. Now we have the law. Now we have a better system where each of us get the opportunity to work our way to God. Each of us now have the opportunity to do enough good works. Each of us now have the opportunity to follow the law to earn that right relationship with God. We have a better system. You're only getting half the story from Paul. And parents, if you have more than one kid, you know that if your siblings ever get in a fight, and parents, please feel free to take a look at your kids at this point. If your kids ever get in a fight, you know very well that it is not wise for you to only listen to one of them, right? You're not going to get the whole story. If you only listen to one of your kids, they're only going to tell you half the story. And the Judaizers are saying, Paul's only telling you half the story. He's not giving you the full picture. Yes, faith. But Paul is leaving out the necessity of the law. He's leaving out the necessity of works. And so these men gave this message of the law because they misunderstood the purpose of the law. And so because they misunderstood the purpose of the law, they pursued it in the wrong way. They pursued it as means of righteousness before God and not through faith. So they misunderstood the purpose of the law, which is why in recapping last week, Pastor Brandon did a great job. Verse 1, Paul writes this. It says, "You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Before your very eyes, Jesus Christ was clearly portrayed as crucified." Verse 3, "Are you so foolish? After beginning by means of the Spirit, are you now trying to finish by means of the flesh?" Paul says, "We came to you with a very clear, simple message of the gospel," which is what it was intended to be. It was not intended, the message of the gospel was not intended to be so complicated that only the intellectually elite people could understand it. The message of the gospel was meant to be understood by everyone so that everyone could put their faith in Jesus. And Paul's saying, we came to you with a message that was clear, it was simple, it was understandable. You put your faith in Jesus. You walked away from the law, you put your faith in Jesus, now why are you so quick to go back to the law to in some way establish yourself before God? Why now, when you know Jesus, are you going to the law to give yourself some sense of assurance that you still have a right relationship with God? Why are you doing that? Who's come in to speak to you that has confused you so much? And so, as Brandon mentioned, Paul in this last section, what he says is you have to go all the way back to Abraham to see what it is that I've been talking about. You have to look back at Abraham when it says that Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness. That Abraham's righteousness before God came by faith. And so that anybody who comes to God by faith alone in Jesus Christ becomes a child of Abraham. Meaning that anybody who comes to God through faith becomes someone in the line of the same thing that Abraham did. Abraham didn't come to God. Abraham didn't receive any sort of righteousness before God based on his works. It was through faith. So anybody who comes by faith is a child of Abraham. You look back at verse Verse 9, so those who rely on faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. So it's as if Abraham is the prototype man. Abraham is the prototype person of someone who comes to God through faith. Abraham is man of faith number one, if you could say it that way. So the passage that we're going to look at this morning, which is verses 15 to 22, it's almost as if Paul is anticipating the arguments that the Judaizers are going to give against the message of Paul. And it's the question of, well, if salvation is by faith alone, then why the law? Why did God give it in the first place? If it doesn't have anything to do with my righteousness before God. So, in other words, okay, maybe Abraham was saved by faith. That's fine. But certainly now God has given us something better, right? Certainly now God has provided us a way through the law that God is showing us now what we must do to be saved, right? I mean, that's the reason he gave us the law, is he's now showing us what we must do. We have a better system. But so Paul is really going to deal in this section with the superiority of the promise and the inferiority of the law. The superiority of the promise and the inferiority of the law. Let's look at verse 15 when he talks about the superiority of promise. It says, brothers and sisters, let me take an example from everyday life. Just as no one can set aside or add to a human covenant that has been duly established, so it is in this case. The promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. Scripture does not say, and to seeds, meaning many people, but and to your seed, meaning one person who is Christ. What I mean is this. The law introduced 430 years later does not set aside the covenant previously established by God and thus do away with the promise. For if the inheritance depends on the law, then it no longer depends on the promise. But God in his grace gave it to Abraham through a promise. So Paul says, let me just give you an illustration. Let me give you an everyday example of what I'm talking about. And the word that is translated covenant here is the same word that just as easily probably could be translated a will, or a living will, a document that hopefully most of us are familiar with, a written agreement. It's on paper. It's a common understanding. And so when Paul says, "Let me give you an everyday illustration," let me give you one. Imagine. Mom and dad write this will and saying if something were to happen to us, we want everything that we have to go to our son. Okay, so they write out this will and they get everything filled out and they take it to the lawyers and they sign this contract and witnesses are there and they sign it as well. And so you have this contract in hand, right? So a situation comes up and mom and dad are gone. And the son is sitting in front of the lawyer, and the lawyer says, yep, well, sure enough, says right here in the will, you get everything. But what I really would like to see happen is I'd like to see you go to law school, and I'd like you to become a lawyer and then come and work for me. Like, that'd be really great. So if you would go do that, when you come back and work for me, then we'll give you everything. Like, what would you say? You'd be like, I'm sorry, what? Like, who is this person to add conditions onto the thing in which we have already agreed upon, right? You don't take a document that everyone has agreed upon. It is my will. It is the agreement that we have come to that you're now, after the fact, going to come in and add stipulations to. It's not the way it works. And Paul's saying, this is the kind of agreement, this is the kind of covenant that God entered into with Abraham. There are many examples in Scripture of conditional covenants that God enters into with people. If you do this, then I'll do this. If you do that, then I'll do that. I mean, there are lots of agreements. This agreement that Paul is talking about is an unbinding and unchanging agreement. So I want to look back and make sure that we have a really good handle on what it is that promise was. When Paul refers to the promise, when Paul refers to the covenant, what is he talking about? And so Admittedly, we're going to be jumping kind of all over the place this morning in Scripture, so if you want to just listen, you certainly can. If you want to follow along, I'll try and give you some time to get there. But I want to start in Genesis chapter 12. Genesis chapter 12, and this is the beginning of God's covenant with Abraham. Okay, so Genesis chapter 12, verse 1, the Lord said to Abram, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land that I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you, and I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse, and all the peoples on earth will be blessed through you. Jump ahead to chapter 15. Chapter 15, verse 5, it says, he took him outside, this is the Lord to Abraham, took him outside and said, look up to the sky and count the stars, if indeed you can count them. And then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. Abraham believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. And so the very nature of the promise that God makes with Abraham is really threefold. He says, I'm going to give you land, right? There's other passages where the Lord takes him and says, I want you to look as far as you can see to the east, as far as you can see to the west, to the north and the south. This is the land that I'm going to give to you and to your people. He promises him land. He promises him seed, meaning, you know, look up to the stars if you could even count them to begin with. So shall your offspring be. In other words, not his physical offspring. It would be all of those who would come to faith in Jesus are counted as Abraham's seed or Abraham's offspring, people who come to faith. Okay, so land, seed, blessing. Okay, I will bless you when you're in the land. I will bless those who bless you. I will curse those who curse you. So land, seed, and blessing. But look at what he does. And this is a passage that we've looked at before, but it's one of my favorite. It's one of my favorite texts. Genesis 15, verse 9. So the Lord said to him, bring me a heifer, a goat, and a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon. Abraham brought all these to him, cut them in two, and arrange the halves opposite of each other. You might think to yourself, what is Abraham doing, right? So he takes these animals and he's cutting them in half and then setting them apart from one another, right? This would not have been a strange thing to Abraham. This would have been a very common ceremony that people would enter into, that if you and I were to make some sort of covenant, if you and I were to make some sort of agreement, what would happen is you'd cut those animals, cut them in half, and then the two of us would walk through those animals together, okay? As a way of saying, if you don't hold up your end of the bargain, may what happened to those animals happen to you, okay? This is very harsh language, right? And same thing for me, right? If I don't hold up my end of the bargain, may what happened to those animals happen to me, okay? So it was a ceremony that two people would walk through together as a commitment to one another that I'm going to hold up my end of whatever that agreement is. Does that make sense? And so Abraham does that. Abraham's setting up this ceremony, and so he has every intention in the world probably in his mind of he and the Lord are going to walk through this together because they have entered into an agreement here. They've entered into a covenant. Look down at verse 17, and part of what we skipped there, Abraham sets up the ceremony, goes back to his tent, and he falls asleep. Okay, Abraham wakes up, kind of pops his head out of the tent, verse 17, and when the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking fire pot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram and said, to your descendants, I give this land. So Abraham wakes up, looks out of the tent, and sees that God is passing through those animals without him. What is he saying? God is telling Abraham, this is a covenant that I'm making with you, and it has nothing to do with you, Abraham. It has everything to do with what it is that I'm promising you. Do you see it? God is saying, I'm the only person who's going to walk through this. I'm the only one who is promising something to you. Abraham, it doesn't have anything to do with what it is that you will or won't do. It has everything to do with what it is that I'm going to do for you. That's the picture. And Paul is very clear to say that it is through Abraham's seed that all nations would be blessed. And I'm not talking about offspring in terms of the generalities of Abraham's family, but as Paul says, one person, and that person is Jesus Christ. That is going to begin the promise that God is making, that it is not going to be about what it is that you have done. It's going to be about what it is that I have done for you. And it is ultimately going to be fulfilled in the person and in the work of Jesus Christ. This is the beginning. And so God makes this covenant. God makes this promise to Abraham. And it is the beginning of a thread that runs itself through the entirety of Scripture. It's a thread that runs itself through the entirety of the Old Testament. You could go forward. This is 2 Samuel chapter 7, God's covenant with David, his covenant with King David. 2 Samuel 7, this is the end of verse 11. It says, "The Lord declares to you that the Lord himself will establish a house for you. When your days are over and you rest with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring to succeed you, your own flesh and blood, and I will establish his kingdom. He is the one who will build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father, and he will be my son." And so part of what God is promising David here is that there's going to come a Messiah, there's going to come a king that is going to sit on your throne of your flesh and blood. Someone is going to sit on your throne forever. And the Lord says, he will be my son. God's promise to David is that there will be a king who will come. And we could go to all kinds of New Testament passages where people refer to Jesus, he's the son of David. What are they saying? Jesus was the one who's the fulfillment of that. Jesus is the one who's going to sit and reign as king on David's throne forever. Or you go to prophets who spoke of future covenants that the Lord is going to make. This is Jeremiah 31. Jeremiah 31, 31, "The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt." Verse 34, "No longer will they teach their neighbor or say to one another, 'Know the Lord,' because they will all know me, from the greatest of them to the least, declares the Lord." Listen to this. "For I will forgive their wickedness and remember their sins no more." The prophets looked forward to another covenant that was coming, where the Lord at that time would take away the sins of the people, where the sins would actually be paid for. Jesus said, "This is the new covenant in my blood," in the upper room, right? Jesus says, this represents the fulfillment of what the prophets have been speaking of for years. And it was going to be the body and the blood of Jesus Christ on the cross for the forgiveness of our sins. This is the promise that the Lord is making. When Paul refers to a promise in Galatians 3, he's talking about that thread that has been running through the entirety of the Old Testament. All of it pointing to Jesus Christ. That Jesus is the seed of the promise to Abraham. Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus is the king of the promise to David. Jesus is the fulfillment of the new covenant that the prophet spoke of. He's that thread that has run through this entire thing. So when Paul writes back in Galatians 3, when Paul writes in verse 17, he says, "What I mean is this, the law introduced 430 years later does not set aside the covenant previously established by God and thus do away with the promise." That just because God introduced the law, he's not doing away with the entirety of that common thread that he had established from the beginning. He's not doing away with that. God has not introduced a new way to him through good works. He hasn't done it. And so Paul knew there would be some that would say, "Well, you know, Abraham may have received it by faith, but we have the law now. we need to follow the law in order to receive the blessings of Abraham. Which is why he says in verse 18, "For if the inheritance depends on the law, then it no longer depends on the promise. But God in his grace gave it to Abraham through a promise." Let me illustrate it this way. Let's say you had a kid, and your kid has a big basketball game that day, right? He's getting ready to play in that basketball game, and you tell him, "Hey, we're excited to watch you play. After the game, let's go get some ice cream. Okay, we'll take you out to ice cream after the game." And he's all excited that he's going to get ice cream after the game, and he goes out and he plays and he tries super hard, and they fall just short. They don't win, right? And so after the game, the kid goes to dad and says, "Hey, where are we going to get ice cream?" The dad's like, "Ice cream? Like, are you kidding? Like, you didn't even win, you know, or you missed like 6 3-pointers. You had like 4 turnovers. You want ice cream? Like, that's not happening, right?" Let me ask it this way. What was the ice cream dependent upon? It was dependent upon his performance, right? The minute dad introduced performance, it no longer became a promise. The minute performance was introduced, it no longer became about what it is he originally said. It's no longer about a promise. It's about your ability now to live up to my standard. That's now what it's about. So the Galatians really have a choice. They can either choose to live by the promise, or you can live by the law. You can't do both. You don't get to live by the promise and the law. If salvation is by faith, then it has absolutely nothing to do with your works. If salvation is by faith, it has nothing to do with your works. If it's by works, if salvation comes by works, then it has absolutely nothing to do with Jesus. The promise is superior. The way of Jesus through faith alone in him is superior. And so Paul finishes his thoughts in this section with the inferiority of the law. Look at verse 19. He asks, "Why then was the law given at all?" It's a fair question, right? Think about it. It's a fair question. Why was it given at all? It was added because of transgressions, until the seed to whom the promise referred had come. The law was given through angels and entrusted to a mediator. A mediator, however, implies more than one party, but God is one. Is the law, therefore, opposed to the promises of God? Absolutely not. For if a law had been given that can impart life, then righteousness would certainly have come by the law. But Scripture has locked up everything under the control of sin, so that what was promised, being given through faith in Jesus Christ, might be given to those who believe. So why was it given at all? If the law is not the way to receive the promises of Abraham, if the law was not intended to give life, why was it given at all? What's the point? And I think he asked that question because he's anticipating the Judaizers, like, questioning here, right? Like, their concern about what it is that Paul is teaching. If the law can't make me righteous, or if it isn't the way to receive the blessings of God's promise to Abraham, then why does it exist at all? And I think there's a number of things that you could say, but I just want to really say one, because I think Paul really just kind of camps on one idea here. And it's a thought that I think Paul gives in a number of his other letters, but one of them is in Romans 7. If you want to just quickly look back to Romans 7, this is Romans 7, verse 7, and he introduces this idea. And this is the idea I think that Paul camps on, is that the law, the primary purpose of the law was to expose sin. Okay? Look at what he says, Romans 7, 7. "What shall we say then? Is the law sinful? Certainly not. Nevertheless, I would not have known what sin was if it had not been for the law. For I would not have known what coveting really was if the law had not said, 'You shall not covet.'" Okay, so what he's saying is that as the law was revealed to the nation of Israel, including this law, for example, this law of thou shalt not covet, right? Paul's saying the function that that had in my life as I read what God's command of the nation of Israel was it revealed to my own life, covenanting in my own life individually. It revealed sin and darkness in my own life. It's kind of like this. Like imagine you got a brand new job, okay, and that job was in, to make up a state here, let's say Tennessee, okay? All right, so you got a brand new job in Tennessee. You're going to be moving in a couple of weeks, and certainly you're going to jump on Zillow and try and find the best house for you, and you're looking around, and you come across, like, the house, right? I mean, this house is exactly what you were looking for. It is beautiful on the outside. It's the perfect location. It's the right square footage. It's the right number of bedrooms that you were looking for. I mean, this is everything that you were looking for. And so you put in an offer, and the offer's accepted. You bought the house, and the time comes for you to move, and you leave that day, and you get there late in the evening, and you show up to the house, and the realtor's there to give you the keys. He gives you the keys, and you unlock the door, and you walk in, and it's really dark in the house, so you're kind of fishing around for the light switch, and you turn that light switch on and find out that the entire house is covered in cockroaches. Okay? Sorry. I didn't mean to give you that visual right there, but today is the day that you realize that your house had a cockroach problem, right? Did your house have a cockroach problem yesterday? You bet it did. But flipping on that light switch revealed the reality of that in your home. The law cannot give life. The law can only condemn. The law can only reveal the cockroach problem. Like, that's all it can do. The power of the law is in its ability to reveal the reality of sin in your own life. And so Paul says, when the law came, it like flipped a switch on all kinds of things going on in my life. Verse 22, Scripture has locked up everything under the control of sin. Paul says, I feel like I'm in prison by my sin. It's locked up everything in my life under the control of sin. And so the law has the power to shine its light into every dark corner of our life. I have up on the screen here, this is Romans chapter 8. Paul writes, for what the law was powerless to do because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in the flesh in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us who do not live according to the flesh but according to the Spirit. The law is powerless. Why is the law powerless? Isn't the law good? Let me put it this way. Who did the law come from? It came from God, right? Could you imagine God giving you something that wasn't good? The law is good. It serves to reveal the holiness and the righteousness of God. Then why in the world is it powerless? Look at what it says. For what the law was powerless to do because it was weakened by the flesh. Or in other words, there's nothing wrong with the law. There's something wrong with us. We're the reason the law is powerless. We're the reason that the law has the inability to give life. Your good works give you nothing to earn anything by way of a right relationship with God. You're too weakened by the flesh. The reality of sin is too great. There's too many cockroaches in the house. The purpose of the law was not to give life, because if it was, Christ would not be needed. If you were capable of earning your own righteousness before God, what's the point? I mean, Paul says, listen, if the law gave life, let's go for it. Like, let's do it. If you are capable of enough good works to earn your way to God, go that route. But there's not a single one of us in this room who can do that. weakened by the flesh. But God, if God had introduced life through the law, God proves himself from the beginning, from the time of Abraham, God proves himself a liar based on your need for the gospel. So as we seek to really apply this text, for me, I think the lesson of the law, and really any time we read in Scripture, we're confronted with the law, you read a passage on the law, what are we to think, and I think the law, the application of the law almost always is us realizing our dependence upon grace, of our dependence upon God to do for us what it is that we couldn't do for ourselves. The way of the promise, the way of this relationship with Jesus Christ is infinitely better than the way of works. Infinitely better. The law doesn't bring life. It's a crushing weight of guilt and sin. Jesus said in Matthew 11, those who are weary and burdened by your sin, weary and burdened by the consequences of our sin, or whether it's you're burdened by, you walked in this morning, you're burdened by anger, you're burdened by bitterness, or you're burdened by addiction, or burdened by some kind of difficult relationship in your life, whatever it is, we have to be willing to sacrifice the way of fixing our own self with our own good works, to be able to sacrifice that when Jesus says, come to me. You who feel like your sin has weighed you down, come to me and I'll give you life. I'll give you rest. If you're here this morning and you have a relationship with Jesus, you put your faith in him for the forgiveness of your sins, and your faith is in him alone, I just believe that it ought to bring us to a place of humility and gratitude when you consider the gospel. I love the way that John Stott words it, and I'm going to end with this, and I want to invite the worship team to come up. This quote from John Stott says, no man has ever appreciated the gospel until the law has first revealed him to himself. Let me read that first sentence again. No man has ever appreciated the gospel until the law has first revealed him to himself. It is only against the inky blackness of the night sky that the stars begin to appear, and it's only against the dark background of sin that the gospel shines forth. Not until the law has bruised and smitten us will we admit our need of the gospel to bind up our wounds. Not until the law has arrested and imprisoned us will we pine for Christ to set us free. It's not until the law has revealed to us the depth of our own sin so that we can respond in true gratitude and worship to the Lord. So let me pray for us, and I think that's what we'll do, respond in worship. Let's pray. Father, as I come to you this morning, I'm sort of hit with just the depth and the reality of our own sin, and in the same sense, amazed that it has been your plan from the beginning. It has been your plan since Abraham to provide a way of forgiveness of our sin. And it's in Jesus that the seed of the promise to Abraham is Jesus. The king of the promise to David is Jesus. The fulfillment of the new covenant is Jesus. And so, Father, it's to him that we look this morning. It's to him that we worship. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand together as we close our service this morning in worship, thinking about God's word this morning as we sing together.
In the darkness we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt.
Lord Jesus, thank you so much for your sacrifice at the cross, for giving us new life in you. Thank you for the opportunity to be with one another, to worship you, to be grateful for that. Lord, we just come humbly before you, just knowing we're undeserving of your love and mercy. In your name, amen. All right, thanks for worshiping with you guys online and in person. You guys are dismissed. Just wait for the ushers to usher you out. Thanks for coming.
Just as you are to worship.